So now we are ready to move into the chemical classification of our chemical messengers. So this is part three of the chemical messenger lecture on intracellular communication. So in this section, we're going to look at the overview of the five major classes of chemical messengers. So again, we come back to our outline, and on our outline now, we're going to focus specifically on these classes of chemical messengers. And so this will just be some general information that you'll need to commit to memory so that you can apply this information in subsequent sections. So this table illustrates the chemical classification of your messengers. And so when you look, here are your five classes of chemical messengers. This table gives you your chemical property. And so if you know if a chemical messenger is lipophobic, lipophilic, that's going to help you determine how that ligand is synthesized and secreted, how the ligand is transported to the target cell, and how the target cell will respond. This table is a great table, but there could be a lot more information that could be added to it. So as we go throughout the next series of lectures, I would suggest thinking about adding additional columns to this table. So for example, as we go through the classes, we're going to go through some general properties. So perhaps you want to add a column here that says general properties, and the information that we discuss, you may want to add to this table as we go along. Let's just begin that if your solute, or your chemical messenger, in other words, is lipophobic, it must be hydrophilic. And if your solute is lipophilic, it must be hydrophobic. That's going to be fundamental for you to remember. So we begin with the amino acids. We have only four amino acids that are going to be functioning as messengers. All of these will function as neurotransmitters. So if you recall, neurotransmitters are a type of functional classification. And so if you think back to what a neurotransmitter is, it's a ligand that gets synthesized and secreted from a presynaptic neuron and then travels through the interstitial fluid to bind to receptors on the postsynaptic cell. And so the four amino acids that you should remember that can function as neurotransmitters are glutamate, aspartate, glycine, and GABA. Remember that we have 20 different amino acids. However, only four are going to be functioning as neurotransmitters. Then we move into the amine chemical class. And the amines are all going to be derived from an amino acid. And the reason they're called amines, or they're put into this class called amines, is that they all contain the amine group, NH2. All right, so here are some examples of amine messengers. And we're going to be spending quite a bit of time this semester discussing various amine messengers. First off, we have the catecholamines. So that's a group of amines that includes dopamine, norepinephrine, which you may have heard in the past called noradrenaline. The last type of catecholamine is called epinephrine. Epinephrine, you may be familiar with it, is called adrenaline. We'll be using the term epinephrine in this class. Now, thyroid hormones are also types of amine messengers. However, they are made from two tyrosine amino acids. If you look at the catecholamines, they are only derived from one tyrosine, not two. Thyroid hormones are derived from two tyrosine amino acids. Histamine, which you saw as an example of a paracrine chemical messenger. Histamine is a type of amine messenger, and it's derived from histidine. And then there's serotonin, which is made from the amino acid tryptophan. And so what you need to do is start organizing this material in a way such that when we move into thyroid hormone, for example, when I say thyroid hormone, you can say, okay, I know that that's an amine, and that's a chemical class of a chemical messenger. We'll be using a lot of these amine messengers throughout the semester. Then we move on to the peptide and the protein chemical class. So you're already familiar with what a protein is. And remember, a protein is a chain of amino acids, or the subunit for a protein are amino acids. This is going to be our most abundant type of ligand. So once again, when I mention a peptide or a protein to you, my hope is that you will think about how peptides and how proteins are synthesized via transcription and translation, and how they can go from a pre-propeptide to a propeptide to a peptide in the various organelles that we've already discussed. And then we have the steroids. This is the other chemical class of chemical messengers, steroid ligands. It's important for you to know that they are all derived from cholesterol, and it's very important for you to realize that all of these are going to be functioning as a hormone. So will steroid hormones travel through the blood? Hopefully you answered yes. All hormones travel through the blood. Our next chemical class are the eicosanoids. The eicosanoid ligands are all derived from arachidonic acid. So this is actually within the cell membrane. All of these chemical messengers are involved in paracrine signaling. Do paracrine signals or paracrine messengers travel through the blood? The answer is no. None of your paracrine messengers will travel through the blood. Here are some examples of eicosanoids, and they all function as paracrine signalers. So prostaglandins and leukotrienes, these are very important in inflammation. Thromboxanes are another example. They're important in blood clotting.